Thank you. Amina, teco mi rallegro. Io preparai la festa, io feci la canzone, io radunai e vicini villaggi i suonatori.
E grata tuoi favori, buona Alessia Saleo, fra poco io spero ricambiarti le tutti. Allor che sposo tu divisa sarai, se come voce essa farti felice, hai il cor disposto.
La senti, Elisa?
No, non sarà se tosta.
Sei pur crudele.
E perché voi?
L'ignori, schiva sono io d'amore, mia libertà mi piace.
Ma tu non sai quanta felicità riposta sia.
E fine amaro,
vedi l'ipocrisia.
Precedo in capo al bosco, io lo mirai da lungi.
Ecco.
Di cui son possessore.
Thank you. Della prima gioventù.
fra noi, se non mi inganno, qualche luogo, qualcuno festa.
Passi, 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 vanno.
La sposa è questa.
È quella.
È gentil. Leggiadra molto. Io ti miri, oh, il vago volto. Tu non sai con quei begli occhi, come dolce il cor mi tocchi, qual richiami a pensieri miei, adorami e verrà, per adessa a qual tu sei, sul mattino dell'età, per adessa a qual tu sei, sul mattino dell'età, per adessa a qual tu sei, sul mattino
Castello.
Oh, e buon signore, è morto or son 4 anni.
E ne ho dolore. Egli mi amò qual figlio.
Ed un figlio egli avvea, ma dal castello sparvi giovane o me. E più la bella neppe la fieto padre.
A suoi congiunti nuova ione reco e certa, e vive.
E quando alla terra natio, ora ritorno.
Thank you.
parra te.
Basta così, ciascuno si attenga al suo parere. Verrà stagione e di si fatte larve vi ha sgombrato il villaggio.
Il cielo voglia
concede la mia bella albergatrice. Saprei.
Nessun mi vince in professar le amore.
Felice te se ne possiedi il cuore.
Thank you. addio. A me pensa.
Ed ancora.
Pur nel sonno il mio cor ti vedrà. Pur nel sonno, pur nel sonno il mio cor ti vedrà.
Non mi dispiace d'essermi qui fermato. Il luogo è ameno, l'aria eccellente, gli uomini cortesi, amabili le donne, oltre ogni cosa. Quella giovine sposa è assai leggiadra, e quello stessa è un po' ritrosa, ma mi piace anch'essa. Eccola! Avanti, avanti, mia bella albergatrice!
Ad informarmi venire lo stesso, se la mandamento va genua, signor Conte!
Al signor Conte, diamine, son conosciuto.
Perdonate, ma il sindaco lo accerta a farvi festa tutti gli abbandono. Io ringrazio fortuna che a me prima di tutti ha conceduto il favore.
Nelle belle mi piace un altro affetto. E tu sei bella, Olisa, bella davvero.
Ma il signor Conte scherza?
No, non mi scherzo. E questi furbi occhietti, quanti cori han sorpresi e ammaliati.
Non conosco per ora innamorati.
uccella, io ne conosco.
Ed io?
Se quel fossi io, che diresti io, carina?
Io? Che direi, signor? Non crederai.
Sì. Che tanto
tradito, alma gentil, conserva il tuo candore.
È vero, al fin sei vero.
Oh, mia sì.
È vero, ti addosso nero.
Ma se ti resto,
thank you. So, as the snow floods in through the open window, that's the end of Act One of La Sonnambula by Vincenzo Bellini. The part of Armina is taken by Eglis Gutierrez, Elvino by Celso Albelo, and Lisa by Elena Zantudakis. Alessio, the admirer Lisa is trying to shake off, is played by Jihoon Kim, Armina's foster mother Teresa by Elizabeth Sicora, The Notary by Elliot Goldie, and Count Rodolfo by Michele Pertusi. The orchestra and chorus of the Royal Opera are conducted by Daniel Oren, with concertmaster Sergei Levitin and chorus master Renato Belsardona. And just to remind you, a full cast list and production photos are on the opera pages of the Radio 3 website. Well, in the interval between Acts 1 and 2, I'm joined here at Covent Garden by Kenneth Chalmers, who's a writer and translator who works in the operatic field. In fact, he works here at Covent Garden. Now, that piece we've just been listening to, I mean, those wonderful long melodies and that very beautifully cantilevered finale we've just heard, we're dealing with a proper mature piece here at Bellini's, aren't we?
Yes, that's true. This comes sort of halfway through his very short career. He wrote it in 1831, which was only 4 years after his breakthrough piece, which was Il Pirata at La Scala in Milan in 1827. Then he had another success at La Scala with La Straniera, which really put him to the forefront. Then a revised version of an opera he'd written for Naples, another piece in Parma, and then back in Milan, but at a different theatre, Teatro Carcano, for La Sonnambula. So this really is him at the peak of his powers. And sadly, he had only 4 more years to live and three more operas to write.
It is an extraordinary short career, isn't it?
It's absolutely amazing, because he's really a symbol of a certain kind of type of music, a certain period in Italian opera, but in fact it's really only 8 years that he was active.
Now, the world we're presented with here, it really is idyllic, isn't it? There seem to be no bad characters, really. I suppose you could say Lisa isn't any better than she ought to be.
That's true. It is very idyllic. I feel that it belongs to something of a pastoral tradition. In fact, some of the text that you've just been hearing really looks back to Metastasio and to 18th century operatic traditions. When Elvino says, "I'm jealous of the wandering breeze that plays with your hair," that could really have been said by a much earlier composer.
Now, of course, the plot is full of implausibilities, isn't
Absolutely,
it?
Yes. We're asked to accept quite a lot. We're asked to accept that these people have no idea what sleepwalking is. They've never seen one before. That they're so frightened of some ghost that appears at sunset that they have to run off to their rooms. And we also have to accept that Count Rodolfo is completely unrecognizable for a good part of the first act, and that no one has ever wondered where the Count's son got to for many, many years.
It is pretty extraordinary, isn't it? And the other thing, I suppose, that's an interesting conjunction is the presence of nothing but virtuous people, you know, particularly virtuous women, and
yes.
The fact that we're dealing with a mountainous setting, and these two things seem to go together, don't they?
Well, yes, that's true. I mean, we have the saying, pure as the driven snow, don't we? And there may be some association there, sort of chilly chastity. But again, Rodolfo says, "Oh, I really like it here. We just don't say, I'm glad I stopped here. The men are very nice, the village is lovely, and the women are particularly lovable."
Now, in this production, we are presented with a sophisticated setting, aren't we, rather than a rustic one. And I just wondered for you how it changes the feel of things.
I think it changes it a little, but it gives a context for the action. I see the action really as a sequence of events and a sequence of situations that Bellini produces a lovely musical movement for each time. And the concept that's been overlaid, I wouldn't say it's been imposed, it gives a context, and certainly visually it gives a very strong context, the lovely sort of Grand Hotel look, the retro element that I think it's very beautiful to look at, but I don't think it ruins the story. I don't think it spoils the story. I think the story comes out of that and is, you know, is easy to follow. The sequence of events is easy to follow.
And I suppose also the idea that a lot of the people we're seeing are in some way infirm, aren't they? They're kind of fragile.
Yes, they are.
And that perhaps makes slightly more plausible the notion that they don't grasp things very well that ordinary
yes.
people might grasp.
Yes, because they've been there for a long time. And they're in a context, in this sanatorium context, where everyone looks pretty well to do. And they've been cut off from the world for a time, so perhaps their grasp of reality is starting to shake.
Well, now, one thing that struck me was the great simplicity of the musical texture. And when I spoke earlier this week to conductor Daniel Oren, he said that the simplicity of the opera is actually one of the things that makes it difficult to bring off.
The form is a classic form. The orchestration is not a very complicated orchestration. Many times the orchestra plays very simple accompagnamento, and the most important are the voices. It's clear in bel canto, but for this reason it's so difficult to play 12 times the same two notes. It's so difficult, or it becomes really routine. So it's one reason. Second reason is very, very difficult to put together the chorus and the orchestra. Very difficult. Then it's a fantastic music. I think that you have to love this music. I love this music. And as we know, Wagner was one of the most famous composers that loved Bellini. And for him, it was the only composer that got near to the infinite melody. I think that he was a romantic composer, but he was blocked by the classicism of Italy. So the interpret should decide if he wants to look backwards or look forwards, or perhaps find the equilibrium. And perhaps this is the most difficult thing.
Daniel Oren. Now, Ken, this simplicity that Daniel Oren was talking about, that paradoxically seems to make life harder for everybody, doesn't it? Because there's no kind of fullness of texture to keep the thing riding. And often things hang on just, I noticed in that act, just things hang on one horn note.
Yes, absolutely. Yes, that point at the end of the tenor's solo, he's just singing in sixes and thirds with the horn. It's incredibly exposed. And in any case, he's just had to sing a very, very long, slow cantabile melody, which he has to hold it all himself. Bellini really is asking the voices to do everything. And that in effect is what we come to hear. When we see that La Sonnambula is on, you look down the cast list to see who's singing, because you know you want to hear a voice, you want to hear a beautiful voice shaping these beautiful melodies.
Now, we've had now one of the great sleepwalking scenes, and I wonder whether you feel that Bellini distinguishes musically between Amina asleep and Amina awake, if you like.
He gives her, in both cases, he gives her two little quite fragmented scenes. The one that we've just heard, where she wanders in and imagines that she's at her wedding, it is full of little bits of reminiscences that it has a simplicity, but it's a very fragmented sort of simplicity. And of course, as soon as someone lights a candle in 19th century opera, a soprano always imagines she's at her wedding. And that's what she does there.
Now, this opera was premiered in 1831, which was also a good year for Donizetti, wasn't it?
Yes, that's true.
In fact, wasn't it a good year for Donizetti in the very same theatre?
In the very same theatre, Donizetti had performed in the same season, but actually just the year before, on Boxing Day 1830, his breakthrough piece, which was Anna Bolena. And it's generally accepted that he had really learned from Bellini's La Straniera, that he'd learned to do something different with his music. And Anna Bolena is a very striking piece, it's a very dramatic piece, it's very fluid, and he had taken things over from Bellini.
And I suppose there is a similarity there in another opera, in that you are dealing with a distressed woman, aren't you?
Oh yes, absolutely. Distressed women are not rare on the ground, actually, at this stage. And they have their roots in a character that Bellini was quite explicitly about, saying that he modelled a character, the mad character in Elvira in I Puritani, is explicitly modelled on this, and this is Nina. Nina Pazza per l'amore in Paisiello's opera of 1789, which is a very, very simple piece, and it's the sort of classical simplicity in that, that Bellini took over. Of course, his mad characters, they have much more virtuosic music, but interestingly, they don't have that virtuosic music when their mind is wandering. They have it when, certainly Amina, when she comes back to life, comes back to reality, rather, and sings this fantastic coloratura fireworks that we'll hear at the end of the evening.
Yes, it's rather a nice touch, that, isn't it? It suggests that in the vulnerability of sleepwalking, a certain kind of simple honesty comes out.
Honesty, absolutely, yes. We're asked to believe that this is what she's really thinking, which is coming through in her dreams. It's an interesting point for the time.
Indeed. Was there much overt competition between Donizetti and Bellini? I mean, did they get on? Did they sort of steer around each other carefully?
It's hard to say, actually. The evidence is that that Bellini felt the rivalry more than Donizetti did, but that Bellini felt a certain amount of paranoia anyway. That when he was in Paris and Rossini was giving him a helping hand, he would write to his friend in Naples that Rossini can't stand him, and that he's he really feels under pressure. But it's the history is rather muddied by the documentation that we have. Bellini's friend Francesco Florimo kept all Bellini's letters, but when he prepared them for publication, he rewrote them, really. He altered them, and he altered history. Another character in this is the librettist Felice Romani's widow, who wrote a memoir too in the 1880s, Emilia Branca, and some of her comments are not to be taken as absolute gospel.
Well, thank you very much indeed, Kenneth Chalmers, for filling us in on that very fascinating background.
Thank you.
So let's now pick up the story of the opera. And just to remind you, Elvino has called off the wedding, having discovered what he thinks is evidence that Amina has betrayed him with Count Rodolfo. As Eglise Gutierrez says, this has left Amina in a state of total bewilderment.
Of course I don't understand, because I'm so naive. And for me, everyone is, you know, is a good person.
So not only are you good yourself, but you can't believe anybody else is bad.
Exactly. Very, very pure. A wonderful heart, so clean and full of love.
Eglise Gutierrez. When the curtain rises on Act Two, we see the villagers pleading Amina's case. She's distraught, of course, and is comforted by Teresa. As the villagers depart, Elvino enters and sings a long aria expressing his desolation, which changes to reproach when he sees Amina. The villagers return, announcing that the Count has exonerated Amina, but the mention of his name puts Elvino in a fury, and he yanks the ring from Amina's finger. But then he confesses in the final aria of the scene that he can't hate her, and that he also can't banish her from his mind. In scene two, we soon discover that Lisa has moved fast. She's caught Elvino on the rebound, chucked her wedding dress over her day clothes, and their wedding is about to happen any minute. Count Rodolfo arrives and pleads Amina's innocence. Like a patient schoolmaster with a not very bright class, Rodolfo gives the villagers a lecture about sleepwalking, which doesn't persuade them one bit, or Elvino, or Lisa, who naturally is in a hurry to be off to church before her luck runs out. In the middle of this hubbub, Teresa arrives to plead for some peace and quiet. Amina has finally fallen into the exhausted sleep that follows emotional trauma. Teresa is shocked to see the wedding preparations, and Lisa can't help crowing in triumph, saying that she deserves to get the man because she wasn't the one found in a compromising situation. This is too much for Teresa, who produces the shoe and stocking that Lisa dropped as evidence that she's the guilty one. Lisa is thoroughly abashed, Elvino is distraught all over again, and of course the dimwit villagers rush to condemn Lisa. Once again, an imbroglio is brought to an abrupt halt by a surprise. This time it's the sleepwalker making her second appearance. In the original story, Amina is teetering on the eaves of the mill, but here she's walking outside through a snowdrift before coming through a smashed pane of glass down into the smart sanatorium via some upturned benches and tables. Listen out for the tremulous sweet melody on the flute that marks this moment. Slowly she makes her way down to terra firma, with the chorus passing hushed commentary on her progress. This is a real challenge for the singer, as Eglise Gutierrez admits.
The difficulty to place when she's sleepwalking, there is a change of the character. I mean, you have to create an atmosphere. At that moment, the music changes too. What Bellini create, what the text says, it's different than when she's like a normal person. It's so, so expressive, so, so deep. It's a incredible challenge for any artist.
As she sleepwalks, Amina sings of her love for Elvino and imagines that they are reunited, and in a long cantabile addresses the now dead flowers that he gave to her. It's all too much for the distraught Elvino, who rushes forward and replaces his mother's ring on her finger. Amina then awakens, realizes that her dream has come true, and sings a joyous and brilliant closing aria in front of the curtain, in which the chorus eventually join in. So virtue is rewarded and everyone is happy, apart from one person who isn't going to get married after all. Tonight's Lisa, Elena Xanthoudakis, thinks the outlook isn't all bad for her character.
At the very end, in Act Two, when it's all gone pear-shaped and she feels so bad for the fact that she tried to ruin Mina's wedding when obviously she's done nothing wrong, and by the end of it, I think she's had, through the first section, rather, Mina's aria and the sleepwalking scene, a lot of time to reflect on her behaviour. And she wishes Amina very well, but I think she's coming to terms with the fact that, you know, there'll be somebody around the corner. I think she's slightly philosophical by the end.
And then there's Anthudakis, who plays the engagingly catty Lisa. So now here is Daniel Oren to conduct Act Two of Bellini's La Sonnambula.
Thank you. possa un'altra possa amarti qual t'avò questi infelice altro voto tra ditrice ah non temer non temer dal mio dolore altro voto a non temer non temer dal mio dolore altro voto a non temer non temer
soltanto per rispetto
è più caro un sciocco e
porti in pace d'esser da te schernito in questa guisa.
Thank you.
compagna sarai. Il sacro rito già nel tempio s'appresta, non si ritardi.
Andiamo!
Thank you.
manifestar non può, sol ti ripeto, sol ti sostengo, che innocente Amina, che la stessa virtù offendi in essa.
Ti fia, che li provi.
Chi? Mira. È la stessa.
Silenzio! Un sol passo, un sol grido l'uccide!
Oh! Thank you.
The end of La Somnambula by Vincenzo Bellini, and a performance recorded at the Royal Opera House, Covent Garden. The Royal Opera Orchestra, Concertmaster Sergei Levitin, and the chorus were conducted by Daniel Oren. The production was directed by Marco Arturo Marelli and is a co-production with the Vienna State Opera. And now the chorus are taking their bow, the chorus master Renato Belsardona, who certainly played a leading role in this opera. And now here comes Jihoon Kim, who played Alessio, who's one of the Yetta Parker young artists. And now next on is Teresa, played by Elizabeth Sikora. The dignified lady who put everything right at the end. And now she's joined by Elena Zandudakis, who played Lisa, still resplendent in her pink outfit that so attracted Count Rodolfo. And she's just given her tiresome Lisa a good slap. And now here is Count Rodolfo himself, played by Michele Pertusi. I think the finest cut suit I've seen on the Roll Opera House stage for many a year. And now here's Elvino, played by Celso Albelo. And then his morning suit, ready for his postponed wedding. And now we're just waiting for Amina in her splendid red velvet gown, and here she is finally. Amina, played by Eglise Gutierrez. Thunderous applause here for her astonishing portrayal of that role. She's had to brave snowdrifts, humiliation, and a delayed wedding, but she seems none the worse for it. Now the whole cast is coming to the front of the stage to take a bow. The all-important member of the team we're still waiting for is the conductor, and now here he is finally, Daniel Oren, who certainly flung himself body and soul into this production. I've rarely seen a conductor with such nervous energy in the pit of the Royal Opera House. Now he's bringing the orchestra to their feet. So, and now once more the cast come to the front of the stage, and so with the applause still thundering away here at Covent Garden, I'll return you to my colleague in Broadcasting House.
Opera on Three was presented by Ivan Hewitt and recorded at the Royal Opera House last week.